I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw
the light.
I saw
the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no stars I.
Praise the Lord,
I saw the light.
I wonder, just like a blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claim for my own. Then like the blind man that got me back his sight,
praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light,
I saw
the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light,
I saw the light.
No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
If my great-grandmother Ada Johnston was here, we would have been a-dancing just now. good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And happy Mother's Day. Real quick, find a mother, give her a wink, blow her a kiss, do it real quick. Again, good morning. If you are visiting with us, do me a favor. Look to the end of your pew and you should have a little slim sheet of paper sticking out. If you could just fill that out, there's a couple of questions. That way we can have a record of your visit, only if you drop it in the golden plate when it comes your way. Now, before we get started on some announcements, I have a handsome man coming up here with an announcement of his own. Jim, come on up here.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can everybody hear me?
Yeah.
Sometimes this mic is not my best friend. This mic, not that mic. These glasses aren't either. Just a part of growing older, you know. I have something to report to you from the Personnel Committee, and it's in sort of a form of a letter to the church, so I'm just going to read it. Following the passing of Brother Roy Barker, our Minister of Music, Sean Ponder volunteered to provide leadership of the choir until the vacancy could be filled. Sean has served admirably in that position for the past 2 years. And during this time, Sean continued to ask the Personnel Committee to find a replacement so that he could return to being a choir member and spend more time with his family. Our initial search for an interim music minister was conducted over a period of several months with no success. Late in the year of 2015, a decision was made to seek a full-time minister of music, families, and children in response to a survey of the church members. This vacancy was widely posted in January of 2016, and after 3 months, there was no success in finding a qualified candidate. Candidates who qualified for the music minister did not want the additional responsibilities of minister of family and children. So the personnel committee came to the conclusion that we had placed too much responsibility on the full-time position at the salary that we could offer. So late in March, the committee decided to try again to seek a part-time interim music director to give Sean the relief that he had requested. We contacted Pat Barker to ask him if he would consider filling in for Sean on Sundays that his schedule would permit. His response was positive, and he began serving on alternate Sundays that he could be available. During Pat's service, we were introduced to Linnell, his wife-to-be. The choir responded with such enthusiasm to the leadership of Pat and Linnell that they were providing that the committee decided to seek a more formal arrangement with Pat and Linnell. When we discussed this option with Brother Chris, he was very supportive and informed us that Nikki had approached him about giving up the youth director position that she had served in for 15 years and asked him about the possibility of moving into a position of children's ministry. The committee met to discuss this revelation and came to the conclusion that perhaps three positions could best fit for the meeting the ministerial needs of the church. The three positions can be funded within the 2016 budget at a lower cost than the original full-time position that was considered. These events and continued prayer for God's leadership has led the committee to make the following recommendations to the church. Music minister, appoint Pat Barker to the position of interim music director for a period of 1 year. He will be assisted by Linnell, who will fill in when he must be away. Sean is very happy with this arrangement, and again, we commend Sean. Director of Youth Ministries, appoint Scotty Simpson as interim youth director for 1 year. Scotty has prior experience as a director of youth and has assisted Les and Gina in their work with the Crusaders during the past year. Scotty will be assisted by his wife, Amber, in leading a program for our youth. Scotty and Amber, along with Nikki, will accompany the youth to Passport this year. Children's Ministry. Nikki Haynes will transfer to the position of Director of Children's Ministry. She will lead in the development of an expanded program for the children of our church with input from parents and lay persons who have worked with the children up to this time. These recommendations are the result of extensive prayers and hours of work by the personnel committee in consultation with Brother Chris. These recommendations will be officially presented to the church in a business meeting 2 weeks from today, Sunday, May the 22nd. And during the next 2 weeks, you church members have an opportunity to ask questions or express concerns to the pastor or any member of the personnel committee. Members of the committee are, and if you're here, would you stand as I call your name? Randy Blades. Heather Dempsey. Wendell McGinnis. Wendell is not, I think he has back problem and he's not here today, but you all know Wendell McGinnis. Mel Ostrander. Bill Prickett. Myself, I don't know if I named me or not, and Brent Thomas. Is Brent here? Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jim. All right, hopefully you all have your bulletins open. Look on with me. Make sure that you all come back this Wednesday at 6:30. For devotion and children and youth activities, 6:30. I still have the sign-up sheet for snack available, so if you want to have a snack this summer, come see me. Put your name on the list. And if you look there, there's some fundraising going on still. Tacos for Texas will be next Sunday, right after the service. It will be a make-your-own taco kind of time. And the cost for the plate will be $8 for adults and $5 for children. So if you would just sign up on any of the sign-up sheets in the foyers on a table, that would help us get a number of how many. And also, there will just for today, I'm extending the T-shirt sale. Hopefully, will pop up. You want to be one of the cool kids with a cool T-shirt. So these are $15, and of course, it will go to help fund our mission trip to Texas. So see me and get your name on this orange sheet of paper if you have not done so yet, okay? And then just also read about Friends and Neighbors Sunday, which is coming up on May the 22nd. Sounds really fun, inviting friends, family. All right, read about that, okay? And there's other things to read about on the back as well, so do so. All right, I've done enough of my talking, and we have just sat for way too long. So find someone to shake hands with, say good morning, kiss on the cheek, or hug around the neck. Go!
I'm just going to sit here. No. Good morning.
Good morning.
And happy Mother's Day to all of you who are here. At the risk of being somewhat redundant, this morning I have a couple of things I'd like to say. First of all, if you are going on the mission trip with us, just as a bit of housekeeping, make sure you see Nikki right after the service. She's got a form just with some information and updates on it for you, just so we don't have to have a formal meeting today. Also, just to say a word about what Jim just said to you to sort of kind of make that sort of a bullet point for you. First of all, Scotty and Amber, you guys, I don't know if you guys all know Scotty and Amber, or raise your hand if you want. Scotty and Amber will be the ones that Jim mentioned who will be coming on as our interim youth ministers. But I want to say two things about two people this morning. One, there's something Jim said that I think we can easily overlook. Nikki has been doing her job for 15 years. And so, which I think is longer than Pat's been alive, right? If I do the math from last week, yeah, okay. But no, that's not something to, and if I can just be so brash as to say for 15 years, we have gotten Nikki at a bargain. And so thank you, Nikki, for that. She's not going anywhere, too. I feel like I have to say that. She's not leaving. We're just going to make her do other stuff. And so, but no, as a part of that, it's important to understand, too, that Nikki is following a calling in her life, and this is the next sort of step in that. And there will be some things along the way that you all will be a part of. We are planning on and praying, looking forward to a day when we will ordain Nikki. And you will no longer call her Nikki. You have to call her Reverend when we do that. And so we'll also be exploring some vocational and educational options for Nikki. And you just pray for her in this time. But also, this is where the redundant part comes in. I wish you all wouldn't have stood up because I was going to ask Sean to come up here for a minute. Can you come up here, Sean? For just like a minute. Just a minute. As Jim mentioned, it's been really longer than any of us, not can remember, but Sean Ponder has been one of those people who, when I have conversations with folks, they'll always say, I wish you had known so-and-so. I wish you had known this person. There are a lot of people I wish I had known, but I've gotten to know Sean and all you do, too. And Sean, I figured you had a Bible. And so I wanted to give you this. It's a Celebrating Grace hymnal. It's sort of a plug for another hymnal. But it's also... hint. Okay. But it looks good on a piano, I think.
Yeah.
But I just wanted to give you a something just as a token of our appreciation for you, Sean.
Thank you so much.
We love you, man.
Thank you.
I put your name on it because I don't want to see it on eBay or anything. Well, it is so good to be here in this place this morning. I didn't get Nikki anything because you're still here. So I figure, you know, down the road. You know, it's so good to be here on this special Sunday. And as we're here, I thought this morning, I came across a prayer from another minister named Ashley Ann Masters. She's a part of the Young Clergy Women Project. And she wrote a prayer for Mother's Day, and I thought it was really fitting and sort of covers really all of the emotions and people who can be affected by this day. And so I'd like for us in our time of invocation this morning to pray her prayer. So would you pray with me as we do this morning? Great God, this morning we come offering this prayer for parents and those who want to be. A prayer for those who got pregnant right away and those who have been trying for years. For those who entrust their babies to the care of another family. For those who cannot wait to welcome a baby into their home and those who are terrified that they are not fit to be parents. For those whose child will get a soccer scholarship and those whose child will never run. For those who proudly pose for pregnant photos and those who shamefully hide their bellies. For those who are proud to be fathers and those who hope the DNA tests are incorrect. For those who pay child support and those who need child support. For those who fight with teenage daughters and those whose daughters have run away. For those who cannot pay for college and those who cannot pay for medical care. For those who homeschool and those who fear their children won't make it home from school. For those who think their son is the best surprise of their life. For those whose children are in prison and those whose children want to be corrections officers. For those whose babies doesn't live outside of the womb and those whose wombs are empty. For those taking hormones and those who feel exhausted from hormone changes. For those grieving what will never be and those amazed by what life has become. For those who are single mothers and those who are now stepmothers. For those who have an empty nest and those whose nest was never full. For the couple who is closer than ever and the couple getting divorced. God, for all of your children of all ages, for all of the mothers, however they may come, whatever they may look like, whatever role they may play in our lives, hold them close and give them life. For today, Lord, we are thankful and we pray for them. In your name we pray. Amen.
The Lord is King. Let the earth rejoice. Let the many coastlands be glad. Clouds and thick darkness are all around him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and consumes his adversaries on every side. His lightnings light up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all the peoples behold his glory. All worshipers of images are put to shame, for those who make their boast in the worthless idols. All gods bow down before him. Zion hears and is glad, and the towns of Judah rejoice because of your judgments, O God. For you, O Lord, are the most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. The Lord loves those who hate evil. He guards the lives of his faithful. He rescues them from the hands of the wicked. Light dawns for the righteous and joy for the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, O your righteousness, and give thanks to his holy name. Psalm 97.
Take out your hymnals. You can remain seated as we sing this first hymn, but let's continue the worship as we sing hymn 106, Praise him. Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing it with me, would you?
Praise him.
Number 588 says that we have come into this house, we have gathered in his name to worship him. Let's stand all across the building as we sing this wonderful chorus, okay? Sing it out.
We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord.
Real quick, how many of you, this is the first time you've ever heard that song? And they say we don't do new choruses here. Too bad it was written in 1978. Let's do the second verse. Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and worship him. Let's sing it.
Let's forget about ourselves and magnify his name and
as you're being seated, the children can make their way up to the front.
Is a little, there he goes. All right, so what is today?
Mother's Day.
You guys all knew that? Did you guys do anything special for your moms today?
Yes, I made it.
I'm going to be I entertained Mom when Abby was making her breakfast in bed.
Oh, that's right. You entertained her while Abby was making breakfast. I remember that. What are you doing?
After church, I'm going to get a bunch of fries and then I'm going to fry lots of fries.
Oh, okay. That sounds like fun.
I made a card.
You made a card? So you guys do all sorts
and
of fun.
A bookmark.
Mm-hmm. Now, why do you guys do special things today?
Because it's Mother's Day.
Because it's Mother's Day. Is it because you love your moms?
Yes. Yeah.
And you want to show them? Because you tell your moms you love them all the time, right?
Yeah.
You guys do, right? But it makes it more special when you show somebody that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you can tell somebody you love them, but when you show them you love them, it's even better.
Because and so it could show more love.
Mm-hmm. And that is something that God tells us to do, is to show our love for people. Because when he wants to show his love to all of us, he does it through us, doesn't he? So when we help give people food, and when we give them help with what they need, or when we stand up to people who are being mean to help other people who can't defend themselves, that's us showing God's love for him, for all of us, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we do things like this on Mother's Day, where we want to show moms how much we love them. And I found out, I said, surely they're handing out something, and it's like the greatest something. So what I want you guys to do is to take these cards, and Chris has assured me that there's enough in here for all of the women in the church to get a free cupcake from Mad Hatter. I know, right? So.
Stacy wants one.
Yeah, I think so. So, I want you guys to go hand these out for me, okay? So, if you are a woman and you would like a free cupcake, then stand up and the kids will bring these to you. There's like a wind coming up. So you guys will take these out and hand those out to people. Anybody?
Children, since you're not giving me one, get out. I have to tell you this. I think about this every year, Mother's Day. It's been about 7 or 8 years ago. I was singing at a place similar to the Golden Saw, and there was a group that had been a country group for years, and they had all gotten saved at a revival like the week before. So they still had all that country mentality, but tried to be Christian acting at the same time. And they sang before we did. And the guy got up, it was the Saturday before Mother's Day, and he led in the prayer. And he had already asked the crowd to give the guitar player a hand clap of praise, which was weird. But he prayed, and he started out the prayer with, Lord, I want to wish you a happy Mother's Day and all the other mothers out there. I think about that every year. Let's stand as we sing the offertory hymn. It's 563. It says, count your blessings. I know you know this one. Let's sing it out. We'll do the first and the last verse, okay? Here we go.
When upon life billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, singing all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done, count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done.
Sing it out on the last.
So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort, give you to your journey's end.
Sing it.
Count your blessings, take them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, bring them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.
Would you join me in prayer? Father, first of all, I just want to thank you. I just want to say thanks, Father, for another day, another chance to come here together among friends and family, Father, and share love and laughter and friendship, Father. Just continue to touch that in our lives and life of this community and church. Strengthen us, Father, to give ourselves whatever it is, Father, our time, our monies, our talent. Strengthen us to look, to see those in need, Father, and help us to, if it need be, weaken ourselves to serve you, Father, in those areas. We thank you again for loving us. We thank you for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I probably need to make a little correction to what Jim read. Honestly, if you ask the choir, Linnell is the choir director and I'm the assistant. That's really how it should be listed. She's far more accomplished than I'll ever be when it comes to that. And I'm grateful that in a few weeks, she'll be Mrs. Barker. I guess I may be Mr. Terry. I don't know. We'll figure all that out. But when I heard this song, I knew that I would want her to be the one to lead it and to teach it. And the choir does such a wonderful job on it. I want you to worship with the choir as they sing, Lord, you are more precious than silver.
Oh.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
And the Lord really be with you if you took two of them coupons. I'm just saying. I won't know. They won't know, but the Lord knows. And so, well, this morning we are in the book of Acts, for this is not only the day which we mark as Mother's Day, but this is the seventh and final Sunday of Easter. And so we look now at the reading before us in Acts chapter 16, verses 16 through 24. One day, as we were going to the place of prayer, we met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination and brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune-telling. While she followed Paul and us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God who proclaim to you a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days, but Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to the spirit, "I order you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And it came out that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought them before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing our city. They are Jews and are advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them and the magistrates, and they stripped off their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. After they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. May God add God's blessing to the reading and hearing of God's word. Would you pray with me? Eternal God, you have gathered your children here as a mother hen gathers her chicks into this place for worship. So Lord, as we are gathered, may you speak to us. Lord, may your Holy Spirit move among us. Open our ears, Lord, that we may hear what it is you have for us. Our eyes, that we may see the way you lay ahead of us. And Lord, may our hands and our feet be about the work to which you call us. In your holy name we pray. Amen. It was on May 13th, 1963, when Governor George C. Wallace sent a telegram to Washington, D.C., addressed to the Alabama delegation of senators and congressmen. In it, he outlined what the governor believed to be the root cause of recent unrest in this state, specifically the bombings that took place in Birmingham just 2 days prior in an attempt to assassinate leaders of the Birmingham campaign of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. In that telegram, Governor Wallace says these words. I'm not going to say it like him. "But during the past several weeks, the city of Birmingham has been set upon by outside agitators who have done everything within their power to create internal strife and turmoil. Particularly questionable was the bombing activity of Saturday night, May 11. It was one case of many where Governor Wallace would place the blame for the violence and unrest that took place here in Alabama in those days on outside agitators. Those he believed were coming from other places outside of Alabama, those who held contrary views, as he saw it, to those in Alabama, those whom he believed were simply trying to cause trouble, seeking to cause problems where, as he would claim, none had previously existed. That phrase, his use of it, was an attempt to shift the source of the strife of those days away from the sinful practices of segregation and the unjust laws of Jim Crow to an imagined group of antagonists, an attempt to misdirect the attention of the masses in order to uphold the status quo and turn their anger and frustration towards those who were outside, those who were different, those who were striving to bring about change and a real difference in their communities and in the broader society. But to be honest with you, that phrase, outside agitators, that was a stroke of political linguistic genius. It allowed for blame to be placed on a group of those who were utterly outside, utterly other, while simultaneously avoiding addressing the actual issues at hand. It was a verbal finger-pointing that created a scapegoat for the unrest and irritation found in those whose ways of living were being disrupted by the inbreaking of justice. It was an attempt to redirect attention away from the actual malfeasance of societal norms towards those who sought to correct them. Outside agitators were labeled as such because it was a convenient attempt at marking those who stood to cause change and bring about justice, and they marked them as the bad guys, the ones who were really causing all the trouble. Now, with that in mind, I don't doubt that if George C. Wallace had been governor of Macedonia, or perhaps mayor of Philippi in the first century, he would have labeled Paul and Silas as outside agitators. I mean, if you look in the passage we've just read before us this morning, Paul and Silas are simply on their way to the place of prayer. We talked about that last week. This place of prayer was a bit of a makeshift synagogue outside the city by the river. The place where, as we saw last week, Lydia listened to the good news from Paul, was baptized, and welcomed Paul and his company into her home. And that ought to remind us that Paul and Silas are indeed outsiders. They're not from Philippi. You can imagine it. They're walking in the city after they've been out with Lydia there at the place of prayer and the women gathered. They come into the city, maybe to buy a little bite of lunch. Who are them folks? I don't know, but they ain't from around here. As they were walking to this place of prayer, Luke tells us, they met a slave girl who had a spirit of divination, literally a Pythian spirit or a spirit of the python, which sounds cooler to me. But it's this idea, it's an ancient understanding of a spirit of divination. And it brought her owners a great deal of money by fortune telling. And she followed Paul and those with him, and she'd cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God who proclaim to you a way of salvation." Now, according to Luke, so far, they actually weren't doing that. They weren't preaching in the city. Paul and his companions weren't passing out tracts on the way to this place of prayer, nor were they carrying around signs or shouting from bullhorns as they went on their way. Apparently, they didn't need to do any of that because this slave girl was, in a very ironic way, proclaiming to all of those within earshot, "Hey, them guys are preaching about salvation." She went before them, shouting, "They've come to proclaim a way of salvation." She was like Paul's own personal hype man or hype woman. She went before him and said, "Hey, guess what? Guess what's coming? Here they come. They're going to everybody to preach a way of salvation. Here it comes." They were getting the crowd, she may be getting the crowd pumped up, ready for what's about to go down, telling everybody what they're about to experience, except in this case, Paul doesn't really want a hype man. Paul doesn't really want that kind of intention. In fact, Luke tells us that she kept on doing this for many days, and Paul became, Luke says, very much annoyed. That's a nice way to say it. And so Paul turns and says to the Spirit, "I order you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her." And Luke sort of casually says, "And it came out that very hour." This isn't a typical exorcism that we see in the New Testament. Paul doesn't expel the demon from this girl because it was having an adverse effect on her. Nobody came up and said, "Oh, Paul, I need you to heal my daughter. She's got this like snake spirit. She's telling people's fortunes." No, that doesn't happen. He doesn't cast out this demon because she was ill, because she was throwing herself on the ground, banging rocks, cutting herself with rocks like the demoniac at Gennesaret. No, Paul orders this spirit to come out of the woman because it's bothering him. He's annoyed, irritated. He's tired of being followed by a girl who keeps shouting his business to everyone. And maybe he's annoyed just because of her persistence. You know, like the way she's always there. Like that guy who's always working the register when you need to check out. And he's the guy who wants to talk to you about everything from the weather to the latest video game he's playing or to the political viewpoints he has. And you just want to buy your Velveeta and go home. But he's there every single time. Always there. Always the same thing. Maybe that's why Paul was annoyed. Maybe Paul was annoyed by the fact that it was this possessed fortune teller who actually understood what he was doing. That the wrong person seemed to be getting the point. That the wrong kind of person was at least acknowledging what Paul was saying. After all, he was virtually ignored by everybody except the women in the place of prayer. And maybe he was just annoyed by the fact nobody else seemed to be getting it. Or maybe he was frustrated because when she said, "These men are slaves of the Most High God," that Paul, maybe she didn't mean Yahweh, the God of Israel, but maybe she meant the chief God of the Gentiles pantheon, Zeus. And so Paul was thinking, man, she's got to be quiet. Folks are going to think she's talking about Zeus, that I'm going around talking about Zeus. Woman, hush. Spirit, come out. Maybe. Paul may have been annoyed simply because of the confusion that this girl caused. But either way, Paul had had enough, so he orders the spirit to come out of her, and it did, without a whole lot of show. Now, this would be a perfect place to leave this story. This would be great. Just leave this in Acts, and then it'd be just like all those other sort of exorcism stories. It would tell us, we could chalk it up as just another sign of the apostles' ability to exorcise demons, of their miraculous abilities that served as evidence and justification for the message they proclaimed along the way. Because that's what happens. They come, they preach the gospel, and people are like, I don't know. And then they cast out a demon, they heal somebody. Oh, it must be true. We could have just left it there. But there's more to this story than just Paul's ordering a spirit out of some nameless slave girl. There's more to this story than Paul's annoyance that leads to an exorcism. You see, the events that follow Paul's denouncing of this spirit in this slave girl, I think, are quite exemplary when it comes to what it's like to truly be a bearer of the gospel of Christ. For what happens after Paul's expulsion of the girl's divining spirit isn't necessarily what some of us might think ought to happen after such an event. Luke tells us that after Paul does this, after he's annoyed, after he calls the spirit out, when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they caught up to them and they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them back into the marketplace before the authorities. Now maybe I'm a bit naive, maybe I'm a bit too hopeful for the good nature of humankind, but I would have thought that these people would have been glad to see a girl returned to health, put back in her right mind, freed from a spirit that caused her to be anything besides, in their eyes, normal, and included back into the community. But my hopes for the better marks of humankind, as they so often are proven wrong, especially when money is involved. It's at that realization that Luke tells us that their hope of making money was gone, that the owner of this slave girl, who otherwise disappears from the story, we don't see her anymore. This is why they're agitated. Their greed, their freedom to exploit a vulnerable young woman is now gone. And rather than simply saying goodbye to the apparent free ride, saying, oh, well, the goose that laid the golden egg has flown the coop, but that was fun for a while. Rather than simply saying that all of these things were just over now, they catch up with Paul and Silas, and they're on the attack. They drag them into the marketplace in order to put them on trial in the court of public opinion. Now, it's interesting what actually happens next. The owners of this slave girl bring their charges against Paul and Silas. And right here, I want to say something. Can we just acknowledge how awful it is that they are referred to here as this girl's owners? And there seems to be no direct revelation as to exactly how many owners she has. And maybe the more daring among us might refer to these people for what they really are: pimps for paranormal profit. The folks bring their charges against Paul and Silas, but notice, they don't charge them with the relieving the girl of the spirit. They don't make the case against them that you've ruined us financially. They don't say, hey, these are economic enemies threatening to rob the community of valuable tax revenue, of a financial stimulus. No, these are their charges. Luke says they drag Paul and Silas and they say this, these men are disturbing our city. They are Jews and advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe. They called Paul and Silas, in a sense, outside agitators. Foreign folks who've come into their city to stir up trouble, to push their agendas, to stir up otherwise peaceful folks who've gotten along just fine before now. After all, nobody batted an eye that this slave girl was telling fortunes for somebody else's profit. Nobody mind. Paul and Silas are here, and they're called out for their difference, the ways they're not like the good folks of Philippi. And rather than charge Paul and Silas with the offenses that they seem to have committed against these slave owners, they'd rather point out their immigrant status. They'd rather point out the ways they behaved differently, because you know as well as I do, so many times being different, behaving differently, is quite often a more severe offense than actually breaking the law. Especially if such differences force me to give up something, whether it's my comfort, my wealth, my power, or my privilege. They point out Paul and Silas as Jews, though later on, if you keep reading in the book of Acts, this comes back to bite them, because Paul is actually a Roman citizen and actually hasn't broken any Roman laws. They claim that they're agitating folks with this outsider way of thinking and doing, even though there's no evidence from Luke in the text that suggests they did anything inside the city, restricting their ministry to this place of prayer outside the city. But for me, perhaps the most disturbing thing about their prejudiced prosecution is what Luke tells us in the final three verses of the text we've read this morning. Really, just in the first sentence. The crowd joined in. The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. And after they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. And then he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. Now, why are Paul and Silas imprisoned? Is it because they broke the law? Is it because they were deemed as dangerous to the welfare of the broader community? No. They were stripped of their clothing and beaten with rods because their actions as agents of God's kingdom liberated a girl from a life of exploitation and abuse. They were severely flogged because the status quo was thrown out of whack by their very presence as ones empowered by the Holy Spirit to break the chains of oppression and a societal system that allows for advantage to be taken of the disadvantaged. They were thrown in the innermost cell with their feet in the stock because the masses can quickly turn on those who are different, those who are foreign, those who speak a word that is different from the way we've always done it. You see, Paul and Silas are beaten and imprisoned, not because they simply preached the gospel. Again, Luke never says that they did that. No, they were beaten and imprisoned because they were easily signaled out as different. And the gospel they believed, the salvation they proclaimed, had been brought to reality, even if it was in an act spurred on by annoyance. It's the kind of thing that cannot help but upset the status quo. All of us who act as agents of the kingdom of God carry with us the subversive label of outside agitator. For that is what we ought to be. We ought to be living our lives in such a way as to upset the status quo, to upset those that are on the inside, not long to be a part of it. And just so you don't misunderstand me, I don't mean we're called to be some moral watchdogs, poised on the outskirts of society, pointing our fingers at those individuals who step a toe out of line with our convictions. No, I mean we are called to be agents of liberation. Women and men who see the sin inherent in social structures of civil religion and the evil evident in economic systems meant to make the rich richer and the poor poorer. Rather than allowing ourselves to be distracted by what some in places of influence and power may label as immediate moral issues, we are called to be people who bring about real change in this world. To bring the good news of God's love to those who have been told their entire lives they are not worthy of God's love, either directly or indirectly by a system and culture that devalues them. To welcome the foreigner, to care for the widow and the orphan, to eat with the reprobate, to feed the hungry, to heal the sick, to just talk to the stranger, to throw the doors open wide and go out into the highways and hedges and tell everyone we find that there is room at the Lord's table. We are called to be the selfless people of God in a world which worships and honors selfishness. And let me tell you something. If you begin to live the words of Jesus, if by your actions, like Paul and Silas, you begin to shift the foundations of society, if you begin to bring about such change as to, in the words of Walter Brueggemann, though I'm sure he stole it from someone else, comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable, there will be those who will point their fingers at you and call you an outside agitator. They will find ways to make you different. They'll point out that you're too young, that you're too old, you're too dumb, you're too educated, you're too rich, you're too poor. They'll say you're a woman doing a man's job, a man who worries too much about women's issues. They'll say you're not being faithful to tradition. They'll say you're too stuck on tradition. They'll say you're too liberal, too conservative, too stuck in the middle. They'll call you crazy, naive. They'll say you're just causing trouble. They'll try to shut you up, to gather folks against you by pointing out how different you are from everybody else, even if it's not true. They'll try to do that. And when they do, I want you to hear this, know this. That means the Spirit of God is moving. That's when you know God's kingdom work is being done. Because the rough places are being made smooth. The crooked places are being made straight. The mountains are being brought low and the valleys are being exalted. All of those things don't happen easy and overnight. They all take time. And the steady power of God's unyielding spirit of love and the courage to be different. The courage to stand up in the face of those who abuse a system put in place to put others in their place. It's the courage to reach out a hand to those who others would simply overlook. It's the courage, like the good Samaritan who stops and finds the man beaten on the side of the road and doesn't take the time to ask for his papers. It's the courage to love the unlovable, the ones you've been told aren't worthy. It's the courage. It takes the courage to love those whom God loves. The courage to be an outside agitator. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, Giver of the Holy Spirit. Help us to have the courage of those like Paul and Silas. Lord, that we may be so infused by your Spirit that even in an act of annoyance, God, that we are so filled by your presence that we change the world around us, that it looks more like your kingdom. Lord, give us the courage to be those, Lord, who call out the things that are not of this, not of your kingdom. Help us, Lord, to have the courage of your apostles, to stand boldly and not just speak the word with our mouths, not just point our fingers, but to live our lives, to be infused so greatly with your love that we can't help but change the world. Give us the courage, Lord, to be outside agitators, bringing with us, breaking into this world, your holy, wonderful, perfect kingdom. Holy Spirit, be with us now. Speak to us. Move among us how you will. In Christ's name, amen.
Stand with us. 335.
Out from this place this morning, you celebrate the lives of your mothers, those women in your life who have left an indelible impression upon you. May you listen for the word of the Lord as he calls you to bring his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Let's pray together. Lord Christ, go with us from this place as we celebrate with family and friends, and as we hear your Holy Spirit speak. Lord, give us the courage to respond and to act. In your name we pray. Amen.